Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for our gathering together once again this day. We thank you because you remain ever the same, the great I am that I am. You have declared to your people that you are God, you change not, and therefore your people are not consumed. And we thank you because you have sent the Lord Jesus Christ to be our own Savior, our own Lord, our own Director, our own guide in life. And we know that he himself, with all his authority, with all his power, with all his word, with everything that he has done for us, will never pass away. He remains unchanged, unchanging. We still have the confirmation of the word that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. And because he is the same and our God Almighty and the Creator does not change, we know that even today, whatever we're going through, you are able to see us through. We ask you, O Lord, that today you will reveal yourself and your truth to us by the Holy Ghost, so that you will lift up everyone out of the dungeon in which circumstances of life might have placed them. For those who do not know you, and because of their ignorance of you, and because of their lack of relationship with you, they are suffering. How I pray that you will open their eyes and they come into real relationship with you, so that their problems can be taken care of you. For those who are born again, but their hearts are failing them, their faith is failing them, their strength is failing them, and they appear to have unbelief, they do not hold on to the promises of the living God, how I pray today that you will energize their faith, quicken their faith, increase their faith, so that they will be able to cling unto you and have the solution to life's problems in Jesus' name. We ask that you open our eyes to see you brightly today and to have clearer faith and greater faith in you, so that today a definite thing and a definite touch will come upon every life represented here tonight in Jesus' name. We believe and bless your name for the great things you will do in our midst today. In Jesus' name we pray. Our hearts go up in gratitude to God for keeping us alive and bringing us together even this very day. This is the day that we should know why we believe in God and why we are following the Lord. You see, when there is no problem, you do not know the value of your faith in God. When there is no problem, we do not know the difference between a true believer and an unbeliever. You see, the children of Israel, they stayed many years in Egypt. But when those plagues began to fall and God made a difference between the children of Israel and the Egyptians, then did those people know the peculiarity of the children of Israel? And so that is why, even though we know that there are problems in this period we're living in, there are troubles, there are persecutions, these are dark, difficult days, yet we Christians rejoice that we belong to the Almighty God. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 1 verse 7. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1 verse 7. And to you who are troubled, rest with us. Here was somebody that knew God. He knew the power of God. He knew that though mountains may move and seas may roar, we can rest in the Almighty God. And he wrote to all these believers in Thessalonica. He said, are you troubled? Are you perplexed? Are you going through difficult, dark days? To you who are troubled, rest with us. He said, the Almighty God and the omnipotent power of God is a pillow on which we rest our head in the storms of life. He said, underneath us are the everlasting arms. And even though many things may be happening on the sea and on the land and in the sky, yet we can rest. And why don't you come and rest with us? You see, those who believe in God, they always rest in God. It is not difficult to sing when there is no problem. You can be singing and rejoicing and laughing when there is no problem. Anybody can do that. How do we know a true believer? If you can keep on singing that same song of joy when there is fire and turbulence and storm, you really believe in God. Hey, I love God. I love the church. This my husband. I love this my husband. I will never leave my husband. When there is food, when there is accommodation, when there is much money, when the husband has a great job and money is there in the family, anybody can say that. But we know a true believer who says, I will never leave my husband, I will never leave my wife, even though there are difficulties, I know that times will change. That's a believer. This is my God, I will never leave him. This Jesus, I will forever worship him. This is our church, I will never leave. Anybody can say that when there is no problem. But when people misunderstand you, when they tell lies against you, when they are after your life, when there is no care, when nobody looks at you at all, and when it appears that you are not having any convenience in the midst of these people, and you can still say that I know the truth of God is in this place, I know the presence of God is in this place, and whatever I am going through, I'm going to stay. That's how we know a real believer. Let's look at Job chapter 5, reading from verse 6. Job chapter 5 from verse 6. Although affliction cometh not forth of the doors, neither does trouble spring out of the ground, yet man is born unto trouble as the sparks fly upward. This man said in verse 7, yet man is born unto trouble. But then look at the next verse. I would seek unto God, and unto God will I commit my cause. He said troubles all around, in front, at the back, on the side, everywhere. Yet do you know what I will do? I will seek unto God. Unto God I would commit my cause. In verse 9, it begins to describe the power, the omnipotence, the almightiness, and the all-sufficiency of that God. He said, which doeth great things and unsearchable, marvelous things without number. But again, I'm going to ask you, will God do anything great if there is no problem, there is no question, and there is no difficulty, and there is nothing to solve? The Lord manifests his power whenever there is problem and trouble and adversity. Actually, you know, we believers have nothing to worry about. You know, sometimes when you listen to the radio in the morning, they would say over the radio, they would say, in the afternoon, there's going to be a little shower. In the evening, there is going to be a real downpour of great rain. When you listen to that in the morning, if you are going out in the afternoon, take your umbrella with you. But you see, people who do not hear that, when they are going out, that rain will come accidentally upon them. Everything they carry may be wet and spoiled. Actually, Jesus Christ has spoken about these days. He has already told us when there will be shower, when there will be sun, when there will be trouble, when there will be earthquake, and when there will be pestilence and famine. He told us before. Therefore, take your umbrella of faith as you are going out, so that you can be protected from all the things that are coming upon the world. And Jesus Christ said, as you see all these problems, all these troubles, all these heartaches, see that your heart be not troubled. That's why tonight I'm talking to you on facing life's problems with faith. Do you know we can face all the problems of this life and it will never dent our Christian life? It will never make any negative mark on our body at all. In Matthew chapter 24 verse 6, and ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars, see that ye be not troubled. Always looking unto Jesus Christ, facing the problems of life with faith. It may be that troubles come in the night. Jesus said that is the condition of the world, that the world will shake from its very foundation, that there will be wars and rumors of wars. But he says, if you belong to the group of disciples, you belong to the people that are called by the name of the Lord, see that ye be not troubled. Remember what I'm going to tell you now. Sinners will be victims in these troubles of the world. Believers will be victors in all those troubles. In these perplexing days and difficult times, the true believers can be definitely victorious in all the problems of life. We don't know how many lives were lost on the Sea of Galilee. We do not know how many of those Jews perished and sank to the very bottom of the Sea of Galilee whenever a storm came upon them. But you know, those disciples of Jesus Christ on the same Sea of Galilee, none of them sank to the bottom of the Sea of Galilee. If Jesus is in the boat, there is security, there is safety, there is protection. That is why I'm always wanting to tell the people that are not born again, do not postpone the day of your salvation. Be born again today, and then Jesus will be in the boat of life with you. And I'm telling you, no matter what happens, you'll be victorious. God will always make a difference between saved souls and the children of Satan. Please always remember that. You are a believer and you are in your office. There are many unbelievers there. Some things are happening to them. If you don't know the God you are serving, you'll become afraid. You'll say, this happened to Mr. So-and-so. This happens to Mrs. So-and-so. That's all right. Know that God will always make a difference between those who are born again and those who are not his children. You as a woman, you are married into a particular extended family. And all other women that were married to men in that extended family before you got there, after you get married, oh, they'll be telling you, in this family, that we don't know what is happening. This happened to so and so. This happened to such and such. This happened to such and such. If you are not careful, your heart will begin to be, you become afraid. But remember, God will always make a difference between those who are saved and those who are not saved. Exodus chapter 11, reading from verse 7. Why don't we read from verse 6? And there shall be a great cry throughout all the land of Egypt, such as there was none like it, nor shall be like any more. If that is all the information you have in verse 6, you will think, well, life is going to end. I'm going to die. There is no hope again. No, it said about the children of Egypt. I heard in the news that they said retrenchment is still going to go on. I heard in the news things are still going to be difficult. I heard in the news economy is going to be this and this is going to be that. Why are you afraid? Did they send the news to you or they sent it to their people? I hear that now there is a particular epidemic and there is a particular disease. It is killing people. The strongest of people are being killed, and it has killed 2,000 in that other place. It has killed 100 in that other place. It is coming. It is coming. And then you begin to say, well, I'm going to die. I don't know what is going to happen. Did they send the news to you or to their people? You see over here in verse 6, they sent message and they said, this is what is happening in the land of Egypt. But the children of Israel were also living in the land of Egypt at that time. Look at verse 7. This one is for me. Look at it. See it for you. This verse is for the believer. But against any of the children of Israel shall not a dog move its tongue. Against man or beast, that ye may know how that the Lord does put a difference between the Egyptians and Israel. Praise the Lord. Now you can see there is a difference between the Egyptians and the Israelites. If you know God, if you are born again, if you have repented of your sin, if you are a child of God, there is a difference between you and the unbeliever who doesn't know God. But let me tell you, to enjoy this special care of God in these dark, difficult, perplexing days, there are two things you must take note of. Because you see, there are some people that are coming to this church, and when some of these things are happening to them, they will say, I don't understand, but I'm coming to church. It's more than coming to church, but I'm coming to church, and look at what is happening to me. I will tell you two things that you need to fulfill as a condition that this special care of God will become yours in these perplexing days. Number one, you must become saved. Become a true Bible-believing child of God. Now, you see what I said? It may look simple, but there are many people that have not fulfilled that condition. You must become saved. You must become a Bible-believing child of God. There are many people that say, hey, I come to church. I'm part of this church. I'm coming since 1919, such and such. I've been coming, but they are not Bible-believing. They have not repented of their sin. These are the people that are still secretly worshipping idol. You are not Bible-believing them. These are people, whenever they have a problem, they cannot pray. They'll be crying. How are you a Bible-believing Christian if you cannot take the promises of God to the throne of grace at the time of problem? I'm talking about people that were still secretly, they want to go and marry idol worshiper. They want to go and marry the worldly people. They want to go and marry the people that don't know God. How are you a Bible believing child of God there? I'm talking about women that when you see them in church, you see this one is deeper. When you see them in their place of work, they are wearing trousers like men are wearing trousers. How are they Bible believing children of God? I'm talking about people when they come to church, they may be singing and singing Amazing Grace. I love the Lord Jesus, how I love you. When you see them outside, the word that is coming out of their mouth is fire to destroy and to kill other people. How are they Bible believing children of God? I'm talking about people in the public, they will drink mineral. But when they go for what they call occasion, that's why we have problem. When they go to that occasion, you will see them, they can drink more than Satan. But when they come out, you will think that they are children of God. How are they Bible believing children of God? You see, where if you want this, in these dark, perplexing days, the protection of God, the power of God, the hidden power of the Lord coming upon your life, and God just going before you, coming behind you, being on one side, being on the other side, protecting you from Satan, protecting you from all the storms of life, if you want that, you must become saved and become a Bible-believing child of God. I am telling you something I'm sure about. That if you will repent of your sin and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and become a Bible believing child of God, I'm telling you, in these days in which we're living, you will see how God the Almighty will be fighting your battles for you. It is we, those of us who are coming to church, it is we that is making the people of the world to say, where is your God? It is we who are coming to church. It is we that is making those herbalists that saying, hey, I can torment. They cannot. I'm telling you, if you become a child of God, a Bible-believing child of God, and you live by the Bible in the day and in the night, in the public, in the private, no witch, no wizard, no herbalist can touch you. They'll be running after you to plead with you and to ask for your forgiveness. I can multiply testimonies from the Bible and testimonies from days our church. You know, testimonies from days our church. How God is mighty. How God is great. And no man, no devil, no demon, no Satan can hurt or harm a Bible-believing child of God. I want you to look at Zechariah chapter 2, verses 7 and 8. Zechariah chapter 2, verses 7 and 8. Deliver thyself, O Zion, that dwellest with the daughter of Babylon. See, that is the first condition. You see, many of us that are living with the Babylonians. Do you know that some of us are already speaking the language of Babylon? Do you know that the jokes and the pranks and the deception and the system and the customs of Babylonians are already in the lives of many people who come to church? Don't you see it? The dressing of the Babylonians are upon the people that are supposed to be serving God. Have you not sometimes seen the painting on the face, on the lips, on the finger, on the toes of Babylonians upon people that say they call upon the name of God? Now does that mean there's no more hope? No more protection from God? He says, if you want that protection from God, deliver thyself, O Zion. Deliver thyself, you that dwell with the daughter of Babylon. Then in verse 8, it says, for thus says the Lord of hosts, after the glory, as he sent me unto the nations, which spoilt you, for he that touches you, touches the apple of his eye. Now, it's telling you that if today you will come to the Lord very clearly and you will say, I don't want to be half and half Christian. Half Christian, half Babylon. Half Christian, half Egyptian. Half Christian, half the world. I want to be clearly marked out as a real child of God. From that very point, from that very hour, anyone that touches you touches the apple of the eye of God. Then, number two, I told you there are two conditions. Number two is that you become an intimate, beloved child of God. You see, when you may be a child of God, and you are in the large family of God, but you are not intimate with God. For one whole week, God may not hear your voice. You may not sit on the lap of Jesus, in the bosom of Jesus like John, for one whole week. although you are not of the world and you are not of Satan, you belong to God, you are not committing all these sins of the world, you are not intimate, beloved child of God. But if you want the protection of God, you want to enjoy the power of God to be working for you in the day and in the night, in the furnace of fire and in the lion's den, everywhere, you must become intimate, beloved child of God in His family. Who are these people that are intimate with God? How does a person become intimate with God? I'm talking about people like Moses. That God said, I speak to him face to face, like a friend converses with his friend. I'm talking about people like Moses, that when Joshua went to the battlefield, just by raising the rod like this, Joshua and the people of Israel were just conquering the enemy. What does it mean to be intimate, beloved child of God in the family? I'm talking about people like Abraham. That God said, I will not do anything except I tell my friend Abraham. That he will not allow an accident in your family or in your life. He will tell you beforehand that this is what the devil is planning. He will not allow any accident, anything to come upon you. He will warn you. He will tell you. He will reveal to you beforehand that this is the way, this is the place where the enemy is hiding. I'm talking about people like Daniel. That the moment he knelt down, he began to pray, God just sent angel from heaven. And the angel came and said, beloved man. A person that is loved of God, he said, from the day you began to pray, I've been coming to give you the answer. All of us who are here tonight in this church, I want to plead with you. Become intimate with God. Become a beloved child of God in His family. Do everything the Bible points out that makes you beloved, intimate with Almighty God. If you become an intimate child of God like that, even the devil will be trembling because of you. You know, when you are an intimate child of God like that, the protection that is on you will be supernatural. Look at Malachi chapter 3 verse 16. These are the people I'm talking about. Malachi chapter 3 verse 16. Then they that feared the Lord spake often one to another, and the Lord hearkened and heard it, and a book of remembrance was written before him for them that feared the Lord and that thought upon his name. Verse 17, and they shall be mine, says the Lord of hosts, and they shall be mine, says the Lord of hosts. In the day when I make up my jewels, and I will spare them, as a man spareth his own son that serveth him, then shall ye return and discern between the righteous and the wicked, between him that serveth God and him that serveth him not. I want to point out some things to you there concerning the intimate, beloved children of God. Number one, there are people who fear God and they depart from all kinds of evil. Number two, they are attached to the vine. That is, they are attached to Christ as the branches are attached to the vine. Have you seen that tree? The wind is blowing and the branch keeps attached to the tree. In the day, the sun is shining. That branch is attached to that tree. In the night of darkness and adversity, that branch is still attached to that vine. When the birds are all flying around that branch, the branch is still attached to that vine. And when it appears that hunters are shooting their arrows, the branch is still attached to that vine. It's an illustration for the people that are intimate and close to the Lord Jesus Christ. In the day, the hotness of the sun may be on, but you are attached to the Lord Jesus Christ. In the night, it may appear that there is darkness, there is no light to pierce through, but you are still attached to the Lord Jesus Christ. Those birds signifying the demon powers and the demonic forces, they may all be hovering and flying around, but you as a branch, you are attached to the Lord Jesus Christ. Nothing will make you to lose hold of Jesus. The wind is blowing in the family. The wind is blowing from the village. The wind is blowing from your co-tenants. The wind is blowing from your neighbors. The wind of persecution. The wind of misunderstanding. The wind of talking rubbish against your life. The wind of wanting to harm you. And all that wind is blowing around you. But you, as a branch holding on to the vine, you keep on holding to Jesus Christ. That's what we're talking about. If you are intimate to the Lord like that, I'm telling you, He will protect you, He will guide you, and He will make sure that He makes you peculiar, a treasure unto Him. He will preserve you in the time of suffering. These people we are talking about are the people that lean on the bosom of the Lord, and it will not be interrupted by any stranger. And then there are the people that pray and commune with God, and their communication and communion with God will never be broken by any responsibility in the world. These are the people that will speak to encourage fellow believers, because the Bible says they speak often one to another. Always cheerful, always sharing the word of God, always encouraging other people, always saying God is on the throne, the promises of God will never fail. Brother, sister, let us keep on believing God. Those are the people we're talking about. And these are people that are always talking to warn and to win sinners unto the Lord. Show me somebody that is intimate with the Lord. At every opportunity, every day, he will talk about Jesus, he will preach the gospel, he will warn sinners, he will want to win sinners unto the Lord. And this is the person that is always thinking upon the name of the Lord in all matters of life. Do you know these people we are talking about? Because they fulfill these two conditions. It doesn't matter what is happening in the world, the Lord will specially protect them and provide for them. Such believers can have faith in God whatever problems may arise. Are you fulfilling these two conditions? Number one, are you saved? Are you a Bible-believing child of God? Number two, are you so intimate with God? You become a beloved of God in the family of God. If you are like that, don't let the tears you are crying, don't let them dim your eyes. Let those tears wash off all the dimness, so that you can see the Lord more clearly. If you are beloved of God, you must have faith like the faith of Abraham, hoping against all hope. Because according to the word of God, by faith, we are more than conquerors through him that has loved us. If you are a child of God, there is something I believe concerning you. I believe that all things will work together for you. If you love God, if you fear God, if you obey God, if you believe God, all things without exception will work for good in your life. And if there is any problem right now in your life, God is ready to work marvelously and supernaturally. Tonight, let us turn all the great challenges of our lives into a great blessing by faith in the Lord. Remember, God has a way out of every difficulty. And tonight, the way of deliverance and the way of protection and the way of healing, the way of the provision of God is open to you if you will become a real child of God and also become intimate with the Lord Almighty. I mean, like David took the sling and the stone and then he threw it on the head of Goliath. There are seven major things that pose like Goliath today, and there is a stone for every Goliath to knock them down. You come and let's share together. I'm telling you that these days that they call dark, difficult days will become the easiest days of your life and the days when the light of the Almighty will shine in your life. Tonight, rise up and let us pray together. Let us pray a kind of prayer that can change our destiny. Let us pray a kind of prayer that will turn darkness into light. Let us pray a kind of prayer that will make heaven to stand at attention for you. I want to pray with you, but I want you to open your heart and open your very life unto God and pray unto God. Greatest prayer you can pray right now, if you are not a child of God yet, is to become a saved soul, a Bible-believing child of God. Don't stay in all these problems of life without Jesus Christ, the mighty one. Tonight is the night to call upon the Lord, and so that you can be saved. If you know there is sin in your life, if you know there is guilt and condemnation in your heart, if you know you are not living the victorious life, if you know you are a backslider, if you know you are not a saved child of God, a Bible-believing child of God, call upon the name of the Lord and be genuinely born again. And those who have assurance they are children of God, this is the time to pray and say, Oh God, I want to be an intimate, beloved child of God in the family. That come what may, I will never look back. I will be like the branch attached to the vine in the rain and in the storm, the lightning and the thunder, in the light and in darkness, with hunters and with birds all flying around. I will be like the branch that is attached unto the vine. The wind blowing will never cut me away from Christ. The difficulties will never cut me away from Christ. And whatever, and whoever will not be able to pull me away from Christ. I'm going to be like a jewel, peculiar treasure in the hand in the house of the Almighty God. Call upon the Lord and let us pray together. Pray a kind of prayer that can turn your life around. Pray a kind of prayer that can touch the destiny of your life. Pray a kind of prayer that will open the gates of heaven wide unto you. Pray a kind of prayer that will make you to stand side by side with the great men of old who took every sin by faith in God. You tell the Lord if there is any dark, any kind of secret, any kind of immoral sin, any kind of evil or sin in your life, get rid of everything tonight and become a child of God, a Bible-believing child of God. God sees your heart. He knows your desire. He knows all those secret things. Talk to God. Let us pray kind of prayer that will change everything within and without. And of course, if there is any problem, God is ready today to take care of them. And to you who are troubled, rest with us. You have come to the place of protection. Rest with us. The devil is chasing people, knocking people out there in the world. You have come into the fold. Rest with us. You have been running about, and here you come to this ark of salvation today and to this place of protection today. There's trouble in the world. Don't go back to the world. Rest with us. The fire is burning that is made by the great Nebuchadnezzar of the world right there in Babylon. And you have run away from Babylon and you have come under the shelter of the Lord Jesus Christ by repentance and faith. Rest with us. And the Lord will take care of you. Are you hungry? He will feed you. Are you penniless? He will provide for you. Dry those tears. Because God is on the throne. And by faith you can receive the fulfillment of all the promises of God. In Jesus' name we pray. Now it is time for us to pray together. And it is the joy of my heart tonight to pray with those people that are coming to the kingdom of God by repentance and faith in Christ. Today, whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. You have seen the need, you have seen the necessity of coming, of becoming a child of God, a Bible-believing child of God. Wherever you are, I just want you to raise up your hand. You have not done this before. You have not been born again. You are just submitting yourself unto the Lord. Right now you want to become a child of God, a Bible-believing child of God. You want all your sins to be forgiven. You want to place your faith completely in Christ. Just raise up your hand where you are. Young man, raise that hand up properly. Lady, don't be ashamed of Christ. I want that hand up properly, not just by your ears. Raise it up properly and declare for Jesus. All those people that are raising up their hands, I'm going to pray with you in front here. Therefore, come out here. Let those ushers, please help me help them. That they come out to the front here so we can pray together. Oh yes, let's be orderly. As you come to the front here, we're going to pray together. You see, to be born again just means that you turn away from sin, you turn away from your idol, you turn away from all the secret things you have been doing in the world, and say, Lord, today I hand over myself completely unto you. That's all. You are born again. And then you believe that Jesus died for you on the cross of Calvary to take away your sin, to take away your guilt, to take away your punishment. And we pray together now. Make sure you've turned away from sin. When you go back home tonight, anything that is a symbol of sin, like all the calabash, like all the juju, like all the things you know that are of sin, you will bundle everything together, throw them away. You have said a final, complete bye-bye to the devil and to sin. And then as we pray together now, the Lord will just completely forgive you and make you his child. Let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you because of the Spirit of God that is winning these people, drawing these people, calling these people to repent of sin and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you because of your promise that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. I pray for these people that, O Lord, you forgive their sins, you cleanse them with the blood of Jesus Christ. Save them in Jesus' name. Give them the grace as they go back home to make right what was wrong and to burn all the things that are the devil in their homes, in their families, and their lives. And, oh Lord, I pray you give them the assurance of salvation in Jesus' name. Cleanse them with the blood of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father, because I know you have answered. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Well, we thank God, all those people that came out, don't go back to your seats yet, listen. All those people that came out, our coordinator with our leaders in your church here, will help you to have real assurance, and then they will prepare you for what the Lord said we should do, that he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. They prepare you for water baptism, and without delay, urgently, as they see that you have that assurance of salvation, you'll be baptized in water. Now, we're going to pray for the people. You've seen this concern. You want to be so intimate with God. Intimate with God that nothing, ever, nothing will be able to pluck you away from the hand of the Lord. And you really want to hand over yourself saying, oh Lord, come what may. I'm having this faith in you that I will never depart from you. You will hear my voice every time. I'll be praying to you every time. A stranger or whatever will not come to break or interrupt my relationship with you. You want to become so intimate with God. Wherever you are, just raise up here and let us pray together. You know the advantage of being intimate with God like that? It is something so great and so deep that we cannot finish talking about. Only those who are intimate with God will be able to know the depth of the provision of the Almighty God for them. If that is the desire of your heart, you will look at your heart, you will look at your emotion, you will look at your desires, you will look at your home, you will look at everything. And anything that is always interrupting your relationship with God, anything that is always making you not to be completely, fully, intimately attached with the Lord, you break off from everything from tonight. Anyone that is always coming to desecrate your consecration, to make every promise you made unto the Lord like nothing, and will pull you back again to that thing you said, I will not do, I will not say, where I will say, I will not go. Anyone that is like that, you make up your mind tonight, you cut off that individual, so you can become intimate with the Almighty God. Wherever you are, you want to become intimate with God. Where are you? Can you raise up your hand with me? I want to become more intimate with God myself. Where are you? You want to be like Abraham. You want to be like Moses, so close with God. Like Daniel, so close with God. Like John the Beloved that leaned upon the bosom of Jesus Christ. Father, in the name of Jesus. Father, in the name of Jesus. I glorify your name tonight. I thank you because you are calling us into intimacy with you. You are calling us to a very, very close relationship with you. Oh Lord, we do not want any wall or partition to separate us and you. We do not want any stranger or any strange thing, like a strange doctrine, to be between us and the Almighty God. We don't want to be like a person in the kingdom of God that doesn't see you every day, doesn't know you every day, doesn't talk to you every day, doesn't partake of your promises and the treasures of the kingdom every day. Almighty God, I pray for all these people raising up their hands, whatever it is, caused by the devil, caused by men, caused by sinners, caused by backsliders, caused by some tempters, making them not to be intimate with you, Lord, I pray, cut it off in Jesus' name. Whatever is disturbing our life for praying, whatever is not making us to be in communion, uninterrupted communion with the Lord, oh Lord, I pray in your mighty power, you will send on the heavenly fire and burn everything away in Jesus' name. As all these people are raising up their hands and wishing in their discerning their hearts to be very intimate with God, I pray, oh Lord, you will do it for every one of us. Do it for every one of us and make us everyone to be so intimate with God, nothing will ever turn us back from God in Jesus' name. I pray, oh Lord, that this desire to be close, so close with you, to be attached to you like the branches attached to the vine, come what may, it will be fulfilled in every discerning heart in Jesus' name. And give us the grace to talk to other people, to win other people, to warn other people, and to bring them unto the Lord every day of our lives in Jesus' name. I thank you because I know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Now we're going to pray because God said it will make a difference between us and the Egyptians. And the sicknesses that are killing the Egyptians will not touch a real believer. The problems that are bowing down the heads of those Egyptians and those Babylonians will not come upon the people that believe in God. We're going to pray for the blessing of God upon you. I'm going to pray for the provision of God upon you. And if you are sick, I want to pray that God will touch you in a definite, mighty way and heal you. And that if you are oppressed in any way, afflicted in any way by dark forces, secret forces, I'm going to command those things to leave your life and for things to be totally different. You know, God is still at work today. Today, whatever is that thing, the problem you want to be removed, just say to the Lord in your heart and raise up the other hand, lay the other hand upon yourself. I'm going to pray with you. I'm believing God with you here. You'll never be the same again. So lay your hand upon yourself and raise up the other hand. Almighty God, I thank you because of this day. Because we have you as God, there is nothing to fear. We know many things happening in our world today. But we depend upon you, therefore we know that there will be a difference between us and the Egyptians and the Babylonians. I pray for all these people that desire healing or deliverance or a blessing from you. I pray, O Lord, you will touch them and you will heal them and destroy the works of the devil in their bodies, in their families, in Jesus' name. That tuberculosis there, I command right now by the mighty power of God, leave your hold upon that individual, be healed in Jesus' name. That diabetes, I command you, come out in Jesus' name. How I pray that those who are sick and they want healing, I pray that right now, the healing touch of God, the healing virtues of Jesus Christ will come upon their bodies, heal them in Jesus' name. I pray, O Lord, for women that are barren and for men that are impotent. I pray that right now you touch them. Right now you touch them. And give them the desires of theirs for the family in Jesus' name. For those who are tormented and afflicted by demonic powers and evil spirits, right now I take authority over all you demonic spirits and evil spirits. Come out in Jesus' name. For those who need provision because they do not have enough to take care of themselves and their families, I pray that miraculously, supernaturally, oh Lord, you'll provide for everyone in Jesus' name. Whatever these people are looking up to you for, they are believing God for, and the promises they are holding on to, how I pray that by faith you help them to lay hold on those promises and have them fulfilled in their lives, in their bodies, in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. And those of us who have prayed because we really want to become more intimate with the Lord, remember when you get back home, anything, anyone that has been causing you not to be intimate with God, remember, if your right hand causes you to offend, cut it away so that you can remain intimate, attached unto the Lord. And let all believers be involved in speaking to sinners, warning them of judgment to come, winning them to the Lord. Let's all be involved in talking about the Lord Jesus Christ to other people. Make sure that when you are coming to church this coming Sunday, you come with people that you are winning to the Lord. You can still pray more and be more intimate with God before you go.